When we first started talking about getting married, Nigel mentioned, what if we have a really big wedding and invite all of our neighbors?
We live in a neighborhood of 400 by 400 yards, and in that area are four 25-story high-rise buildings. And in those buildings are 4,000 people.
As we kept talking, we realized a lot of our neighbors don't have cars. A lot of our neighbors would never step foot in a church building. And realistically, the only way they could come to our wedding is if the wedding came to them.
We were driving home from church and we had just heard a great sermon on the book of James. And then on the ride home, Sharon said, we ought to really do something that matters. And I thought she was going to suggest we work at a soup kitchen or maybe do something on Saturday afternoons to help people. And instead, she introduced the idea of adoption.
We saw a picture in a newsletter of George. The ad said that he was healthy, but was born with no arms and desperately needed a loving home. And I really felt that God was speaking to me and saying, I want you to adopt this boy. I have a plan for this boy to be in your family. And I was actually afraid to even mention it to Mike because it was such a departure from anything we'd ever done.
When I was in control, I drank everything away. I drank away my marriage, I drank away my children, I drank away my relationships. My life basically caved in and crashed in around me.
Our marriage was at a bad place. I knew that I couldn't move forward with the way things were going. And I made a decision to file for divorce.
Should we go out there or out here? Let's go out here because we're going to show you the wedding site and everything. Folks don't normally have a wedding next to something like this. And it isn't always this bad, but as you can see, there's a bit of garbage strewn around today. But it really worked out well on our wedding day.
This is where we said I do. And we had all of the chairs right here and our neighbors, and you can see the buildings. And the whole neighborhood could hear our wedding, and a lot of people came down and joined the party when they heard songs and prayers in their languages.
Because we wanted to include as many people as we could in our wedding, we actually ended up deciding to have two wedding ceremonies and two three-hour receptions in one day.
I think as we make our major life decisions about who we'll marry, what our career will be, where we'll live, how we'll spend our time, I think we all have defaults in our life that kind of dictate or guide us in these decisions. As we were planning our wedding, there's so many cultural defaults that may not necessarily be bad or good, but they just are handed to us. And I really felt God speak to me to challenge how I would do our wedding and how we would live our lives, that our new defaults would be what would glorify God most.
To paraphrase 2 Corinthians 8, verse 9, Christ, who was rich, became poor so that we, through his poverty, could become rich. And as Jesse and I were getting married, we wanted our lives to reflect this verse, to intentionally become poor in some way by moving into a high-needs neighborhood. And it has certainly enriched our lives.
Before we got married, people told us that we should maybe not live in our neighborhood for our first year of marriage, that we should take it easy and really build into our marriage. And we really felt strongly that we should stay in our neighborhood and that we should start our marriage by serving God together, because that's what we wanted our whole lives to look like. There's something powerful about seeking first God's kingdom with your spouse that makes your love go deeper and stronger than if you were just seeking first your marriage.
There you go.
We got George home and things started to go fairly well and he got healthy and happy. And I thought, okay, we've done our deal. This is our grand contribution to the kingdom. God should be very happy with us now. And I went by the computer one night and Sharon was sitting there looking at the internet and she had found James and it said boy born in India with no arms. And Sharon had the idea, why don't we make them brothers? Wouldn't that be amazing?
And serving God really takes a lot of submission and it takes a lot of sort of repetitious, unglamorous kind of work. I think people can look at our family and see 12 vivacious kids and think, wow, this, you know, what a beautiful thing. But that involved years and years of doing the same thing over and over again. And we have to be willing to kind of make yourself nothing sometime. And then he blesses those efforts. And in the end, he makes it into something beautiful.
With Sharon and I think it's that we actually don't focus on our marriage that makes it a great one. And Satan sometimes whispers in your ear when you're tired or alone or 3 a.m. and says, your friends are going to Jamaica next week. And they're just going to sit on the beach and stare into each other's eyes. And you don't ever get to do stuff like that. Ha ha. And you're like, what have I done to myself? And then you have other moments where you go right to the tip of the mountain and you realize it's going to have effects for eternity.
I think this adoptive mission we're on has been the best thing for our marriage because I see people that have been married as long as us struggling to find common ground and find common interests and stay interested in each other. And I feel like we have this big God adventure that we're on together and that's the most romantic thing you could be doing.
There's 140 million orphans around the world and like how can we just use our marriage to just ignore that whole worldwide problem. I don't know how you're gonna face God at the end and say, oh, you put us together and you found us and you made us and what we decided to do with our marriage was get comfortable.
The day that Susan threw me out of the house was a day that literally saved my life. And what transpired from that night was a series of events that only God could orchestrate.
When I was working, there were Christian people around me, and they seemed like they had good relationships with their families. And that was really what I wanted.
My wife started taking our kids to a church, and I'm thinking she's sending them to a cult. And so I decided I'm going to go visit church with them. That morning, God got my attention in a really big way, and I ended up giving my life to Christ. God restored my marriage. My ex-wife and I were remarried. We became best friends. But something important changed. Our marriage wasn't just about each other and our children and our home and our dreams, but it also included helping other people in any way that we could. That's where our heart for missions really started. And that's how Crisis Aid was born.
Right now we're in East Africa. And this is little Thomas Ginn, he's 4 years old. And as you can see, he's severely malnourished.
Crisis Aid is now building a children's clinic in an area that has no doctor. We're starting another building program for girls who are victims of sex trafficking. As well as looking at the United States, our inner city work, we want to expand that significantly.
We are headed to the center. Our mission is really to reach the lost. We provide packages of food that include groceries, canned goods, meat, vegetables, and bread, just depending on what's available.
I love standing back in a corner and watching her. She glows. Just to see the life of God come out of her. And you can see it in her face, in her expression. And even as she limps with her cane, there's a difference, you know? She's more beautiful to me today than the day we got married, the second time. Have we been living our own life and, you know, trying to build the good life for ourselves? we wouldn't have that experience. We would be missing that.
We know that restoration is possible. And it's exciting to see what God's going to do and how he's going to use it after all of these years, you know, because, it's been a while now.
Well, I've never been busier in my entire life, and I'm supposed to be retired. We don't see any reason to slow down, But, when you're on a mission, when God puts this thing in your heart and you really find it, it's not work. It's a privilege. If married people want to know how to be missional, there's about 3,000 verses in the Bible that deal with poverty and injustice. Pick one and build your life around it. You'll be in the center of God's will.
I think a common way that people view relationships and marriage is finding someone that you can spend time with, that you can do fun things with, you can have a family, you can buy a home. I just felt like marriage could have a much stronger, more powerful, more significant meaning than just someone who I could grow old with.
I think one thing about marriage is that it doubles what you individually desire. If you individually desire to settle down, then you'll doubly settle down. But if you individually desire to be on mission, then you'll doubly be able to do that. And seeking first the kingdom, doing hard things, even suffering.
God is pleased with a marriage that doesn't dwell and consume itself and get caught up in its own roots and vines, but is seeking to reach out to the world around it and have an actual lasting impact for his kingdom.